for all of us. So all the best for to Dr. Kshitij for today's topic, and you can proceed with your presentation, sir.
Thank you, Surinder, for your kind words, and thank you, Shanai sir and CIMS team for providing this platform. Today we will be discussing this topic, zygomatic complex fracture, and I have divided it under these heads: anatomy, its importance in management. We will see different classifications, clinical evaluation, management, different options, and we'll be discussing few cases. Now, zygomatic complex fracture. The zygoma, it form lateral middle third of the face, and because of its prominent position, it is more prone to fracture. Now, this bone as such is strong, so any attachments are relatively weak. So whenever an impact occurs, the fracture is usually not through the body, but its attachment processes which are the weak areas. And if you want to understand the fracture line, the best is we should start with this weak line, inferior orbital fissure. So the fracture line starts anteriorly, it runs here, superiorly on the lateral wall of orbit, and inferiorly also it runs, and then also on the arch. So it's a complex fracture, involves the multiple bones. Now, when we go through the literature to study this zygomatic complex, we come across different terms like tripod. So first we will clear whether it is a tripod or it's a tetrapod. Now, as we see here, the zygoma bone as such has four processes, that is frontal, temporal, maxillary, and orbital, which many a times we miss, which joins with the sphenoid bone. So we should understand here that this is not a tripod fracture, but a tetrapod fracture. Now, why is it important knowing this, whether it is tripod or tetrapod? So it has its importance in the management when we go in the exposure and fixation. Now, if we compare this tetrapod, means four leg. So if we compare this with a four leg chair, and in the four leg chair, if we can see two legs are on the floor, then we are not sure whether the remaining two legs are on the floor or off the floor. But if we see that three legs are touching the floor, then we can say that fourth leg must be touching the floor. Same goes in the management part also. Like if we have exposed only two sides and we can see that they are reduced anatomically, but we cannot say 100% that whether the remaining two legs are anatomically reduced or not. Maybe the two sides which we are seeing are looking anatomically reduced, but there may be axial inclination or rotation of the zygoma. So it's always a better idea to see three processes. Now, in maxillofacial region, in reduction, our goal is to restore the anatomy in all three dimensions. That is, we want to restore the projection, width, and height. Now, zygoma, it helps in restoring the width. Zygomatic prominence is also anteroposterior width. And additionally, the arch, it helps in restoring the projection to the face. Now, in PG exam also this question may be asked, like, which is the key area in determining the adequacy of reduction in zygomatic fracture? Like, we should ideally see four sites, but if you want to rely, which is the most reliable site? So we can expose this frontozygomatic area, zygomatico-temporal area, zygomatico-maxillary buttress, but most reliable call is this sphenozygomatic suture. Why so? Why not zygomatico-frontal suture? Because this is a narrow area, and we cannot rely on the narrow area. Like clinically, we may see that bone-to-bone approximation is there, but actually there may be inflammation or rotation around that point. So we should try to see the wider surfaces like sphenozygomatic area if we want to rely on reduction. Now for fixation, in maxillofacial region, we usually address the buttresses, which are the sturdy or strong areas. So we all know that there are vertical buttresses and horizontal buttresses. So zygoma also take parts in forming the vertical and horizontal buttresses. And additionally, we can see this arch helps in forming the sagittal buttress, we can say, that is giving projection to the face. So bringing back the zygoma into its anatomic position is important to give good control to the face. Now again, a question may come, which is the most stable area for fixation or plating in ZMC fracture? That is, we are addressing the buttress, but in that buttress also, which is the most strong area? So we can see in this image, like this is the most stable area, most sturdy area, zygomaticum frontal suture area. Then is the this zygomaticum maxillary buttress. Then is the this arch. And last is this infraorbital region. Means if we compare strength wise, infraorbital region is most weak. We cannot rely more, we cannot do more manipulation in this region. The bone is relatively weak. If you want to do only 2-point fixation, then strength wise is 1 and 2, that is FZ and buttress are better choices. Now we should also see attachments to the ZMC and its relevance in management. Now attachment to ZMC, masseter muscle attach and it pulls us down, whereas the temporalis fascia attach to the arch and it pulls it up. So whenever the fracture occurs and whenever this envelope is intact, if it, more displacement is not there, then if we reduce, this fascia tries to maintain it into its position. And additionally, this prevents this displacement also, fascia. Now, which are other attachments to the ZMC? So there is a Wittenhouse tubercle, which is below the FZ suture on the lateral wall of the orbit. Yeah, and gives... Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So there is a Wittenhouse tubercle on the lateral wall of the orbit and which gives attachment to the suspensory ligament, which maintains the position of the globe. So if the fracture occurs and displacement occurs above this point, that is Wittenhouse tubercle, then that ligament will come down, the globe position will come down, also the palpebral ligament will come down. So the that will lead to the anti-mongoloid feature, we can say. Plus additionally, as the what this separation is occurring there, the orbital volume is also getting enlarged. And there will be enophthalmos also and diplopia also. Plus additionally, in the floor, the entrapment of the soft tissue or the rectus muscle can occur, which also can lead to diplopia. Now we need to understand which nerve may get involved. So we all know that infraorbital nerve, usually it is through the canal course, it may get involved and lead to paresthesia for the area which it supplies. Plus additionally, the patient may complain of altered sensation or non-patient, if you see vitality, so may not respond to vitality test because the dental nerves are also involved in this fracture. So which recovers in 6 to 8 weeks times usually. Now any fracture or anything usually we classify for the our ease for discussion and for study purpose. So the most easy I found is this given by the Z for this ZMC, which is very simple. Like it can be A, that is isolated, like only arch, only lateral wall or only infraorbital, or monofragment, that is all linear clean fractures, or multi-fragment, that is comminuted. A similar one given for mid-phase by the Manson also can be taken, like low velocity or high velocity. Low velocity means impact is like by interpersonal violence, and where the linear fractures are there, we can call it monofragment type of fracture. High velocity, which are common nowadays because of motor vehicle accidents. So in that, as the energy is more so multi-fragment, that is comminuted fracture. Now these classifications help in management also. That more comminuted the fracture, we need to do more fixation. Whereas if it is monofragment, maybe less fixation will work. Now there are a list of classification given for the ZMC. So from academic point of view or from exam point of view, we just should know that these are the different sets of classifications given year-wise. And we won't go into detail of these, like, but we should know that there are different sets of complication, sets of classification. This given by Rose also is very useful. And one thing we should know about this is there is vertical axis and longitudinal axis. So what is the importance of knowing this vertical and longitudinal axis? They will decide the axis, they will form the axis of rotation around which the fracture fragment may rotate. So there are vertical axis which runs through the FZ body, buttress and six region, and horizontal axis, that is through the infraorbital and arch region. Now why should we know this? Is there any clinical or treatment point of view relevance? Yes. It is said that the fracture which rotate around the vertical axis are stable after reduction, so you may or may not need the fixation. Whereas the fracture which runs through this horizontal axis, they are usually unstable after reduction. Now how they decide is how it happens. Like in the axis of rotation vertical, if you see, the impact may be ahead of this or behind this, and that will decide the rotation of the fragment. Like if the impact is ahead of this line, the rotation, medial rotation will happen. And if the impact is behind this line, the lateral rotation will occur. Same way for horizontal axis, if the impact is above this axis, then rotation that way and below. So same way rotations are there, and you should understand why and how it helps. Now next step is clinical evaluation, and this involves inspection and palpation of the orbital rims and all the bony margins, and we should try to compare one side with the other. And there are many clinical signs and symptoms. Now again, why is it important to see the signs and symptoms? There are many signs which are just there, but they don't as such help in taking decision making for the treatment. So we'll focus more on the clinical features which help in taking decision for treatment. So the features which usually help or which says that we need to intervene are if there are some functional impairment or aesthetic deformities. Now, functional impairment can be like the zygoma is depressed down and it may mechanically interfere with the movement of the mandible by mechanically locking with the cornea. So this is one of the main functional issue, trismus. Then entrapment of the muscle or orbital volume increase or some that may be the reason for diplopia or infraorbital nerve involvement compression, that is paresthesia in this region. So these are functional reasons which need to be addressed. Aesthetic deformities definitely can be like malar flattening, mid-face whitening, or glome wall positions. So these will be indications for treatment. There are other features like periorbital edema, ecchymosis. They are there, but they will resolve with time, may not need as a direct treatment. Now, if the decision of intervention or treatment is done, then when should we address? That is again a question. So early is always better. If patient, we can manage before the edema forms. That is the best time. But usually patient reports a little like next also the edema forms. So we can, if it is extensive edema, we can wait for the edema to subside. Sometimes we may take a call that we can manage in the edema also, but it's a surgeon's choice that we can wait for 5 to 7 days for the edema to subside and then we can intervene. What if we the patient comes late, like neuroclearance we may not get and patient report late. So in such cases, the same entity, if we have been addressed early, the treatment would have been less aggressive, less fixation. But if it reports late, we may need more fixation. Why so? Because during that course of time, what happens, normal healing process, the bony fragments, they undergo physiologic resorption. So if we reduce them, they won't lock with each other. That interdigitation will be locked. So they will need more amount of fixation as compared to the early intervention. So that is important. Plus additionally, fibrosis also will be there, which need to be managed. Now next, an important thing in ZMC is optical evaluation. So basic evaluation we can do, like we can check whether the vision is normal, whether there is any diplopia. We can check the movements of the eye in all the directions. And whenever needed, we should take the optical opinion. So we should be in close coordination with the ophthalmologist in managing such cases. Like prior also we can take a call, and after management surgical intervention we can take an opinion of them. And that is important from medico-legal point of view also. So what are management options in managing ZMC, zygomatic complex fractures? So we have a set of options. So option number one is observation, indirect reduction, then direct reduction and fixation. This we will be discussing in the coming slides. This immediate reconstruction by grafting usually not required. This is needed when there is an extensive like bone loss is there, so we may have to reconstruct it. And one more option which we should know, we will discuss in here, like delayed reconstruction. Like what if the patient reports late? Then we need to again evaluate the case on the same areas, like whether there is any functional impairment or aesthetic issues. If there is functional impairment like trismus because of locking on the coronoid, then we need to do surgical correction like osteotomy and correction. But only if there are aesthetic issues like depressed malar region, then you may not take that may not be that much aggressive in doing the osteotomy. You can just do augmentation like grafting either with the bone or with the med core. This is when we report patient reports late. Now we will say observation. Observation also can be called like conservative management or non-surgical management, but I would prefer to call it as a supervised spontaneous healing. Now, in this means we don't have to do as such any surgical intervention, but just keep the patient under follow-up. Now, in which cases we need to choose this? The cases where the fracture is not displaced or minimally displaced and causing no functional or aesthetic issues, in those will be the cases, and just keep the patient on the soft bed. Additionally, if some displacement of the fracture is there, but the patient age is more and doesn't need that much intervention for aesthetic issue, again, we can just keep the patient on follow-up. So this is the first, and many of cases we can manage just on this basic observation. Next is indirect reduction. Here, in the mandible, we can directly hold the mandible and manipulate it. But this is not same with the zygoma. We cannot hold it. So all the reduction process will be some sort of incisions and surgical procedure will be involved. So here we will not be, in this option, we will not be able to see the fracture line as such, but it will be surgical procedure. These are the two age-old techniques, Gillies temporal and Keen's intraoral. Through this incision, we can pass the instrument and reduce the fractures. So these are commonly used indirect reduction techniques. Now, these may or may not involve fixation. If needed, we can do indirect fixation or direct fixation in this approach. In short, we will see these approaches. Now, Gillies temporal approach, the incision in the temporal region, taking the superficial temporal artery into consideration, this hides very well in the hairline, an oblique incision. And for this incision, the most important thing, we should know the planes. That is temporalis fascia and temporalis muscle is the plane. Through these two layers, our instrument will pass. The reason is the temporalis muscle passes below the arch and fascia attaches here. So if we are through the plane, we can go behind the zygoma, body of the zygoma. So how to be confirmed whether you are in the right plane? As you go layer-wise, first you will see the shining fascia. And as you cut the fascia, the muscle will pop out. That is the right plane. Then through that plane, you can first pass the flat-ended instrument like Hovarthy elevator and create a space, and then a Rose elevator is the preferred one. Initially, Bistros was also used, but this is modified one, which has a simulating arm or the effort arm. Now, this elevating arm will go in the desired area, and to confirm it whether it is in the desired area, we have this effort arm, which we can close and see the, which will match with the tip position of the elevating arm. Then when we open it, the hinge is locked here. So when we open it, these two arms are parallel. And then when you are in the right position, we can apply the force. So this is how the ideal way of holding the instrument, one hand here and one supine here, and apply the elevating force. And the assistant can hold the head and can also feel for the reduction. Whenever the reduction occurs in such cases, it's very pleasure moment when the click sound comes. So it's very satisfying that we have reduced the fracture. And many a times that get locked also, may not need any fixation. The similar one is the Keen's one, but this is an intraoral and preferred options many a times because this is a shorter route and more direct approach. And incision is also intraoral. So small intraoral incision, go behind the zygomatic buttress, behind the body of the zygoma and try to reduce it. Any instrument like even an artery forceps, AV artery forceps or Mount's elevator, surgeon's reference can work. And additional advantage in this approach is if we can just reduce and leave it if it is stable, and if needed, we can just extend the incision and fix this site very easily. This is the additional advantage with the Keen's interval approach. There are other approaches also like the percutaneous hoop or the Scarrow-Girard hoop. Now it's totally the surgeon's preference which method he wants to use. I never used this technique, but after my fellowship from Germany, I have seen that people were using this technique very nicely. A small stab incision there, put the hook and this method, and then evaluate the reduction on the scan intraoperatively also. So seeing is believing, what we can call. If we see any technique and we can master it. So percutaneous hook or also coral Girard screw, which will engage the zygoma bone as such, and we can use for reduction. Now next is direct reduction and fixation. That is, we will see the fracture site directly. We can reduce and fix as and where needed. Now we have already seen the buttresses and the points which are most stable, which need to be addressed. And these are the four points which we can fix in the zygomatic complex fracture. All four points, we all know, FZ, arch, buttress, and infraorbital. And strength-wise, which side is how much strength. And last is the floor reconstruction whenever needed. So in maxillofacial region, usually we come across the questions like which first, sequencing, order of reduction. These are the questions which we will encounter. Char karna hai to, which one should be the first? So I found this in the AO, like if the plan is to fix all four clients, all four points, then start with the F0. In that also they give that first put the screw on this segment, that is the zygoma, only one screw, then use the plate to use the fracture and put the second screw. Done. Only two screws initially, then fix this side, and finally tighten, put this remaining two screws. If you are putting all four screws. But it's not that always we put the four screws. Also, one important thing is, this is one given, but it is not hard and fast to follow this only. It is maxillofacial fractures are like solving the jigsaw puzzle. And case-based, we need to take a call which first. Like we usually try to begin with the reference point that are least communicative. Like we try to grow from known to unknown. That will help in reduction. So it's not that always we fix the all four points. And in the literature also, we may see like 1 point is better or 2 point, 2 point or 3 points. So we can't take a generalized call like 3 point is better or 4 point is better. It should be customized, individualized as per the patient's need. Less is more in such cases, but it should be adequate also. So algorithm given by the Edward Ellis, which he, like whether we need a floor reconstruction or not, and like try to reduce first. If it is stable, leave it. If not stable, fix the buttress. If stable, leave it. If not stable, then expose the FZ and fix that also. And finally, when you are satisfied with the stability of the reduction, then finally floor reconstruction. Same way we can discuss this one more time through this, like first try to reduce the fracture. If you are satisfied with the reduction and stability, try to move it with some pressure. If it is stable, no fixation is needed. If you want to fix, start with the FZ first. If you feel that it is inadequate, then second point which should be added is the FZ. If you want more amount of fixation, then intraorbital, this is given in AO. And last is the arch, and then is the floor reconstruction. This is when you want to take a on table call. You are not planned that all 4 points I will be fixing. Like in comminuted fractures, we may plan that all 4 points or 3 points you may prior plan, but in linear fractures or mono fragment, you may take a call on table. So whenever you are doing the manipulation in this area, we should also take, this should be done prior also, and at the end of manipulations on fixation, that whether the eye movements are normal. We should try to hold the rectus ligament, inferior rectus muscle ligament to the inferior fornix, to the conjunctiva, and try to move the eye whether the movements are smooth. If there is an entrapment, that should be managed. So this is a force reduction test. Now we have discussed these 4 points of fixation. So these are the 4 points of fixation. Now we should also see how to approach them. So to approach them, the most simple or most direct is the intraoral vestibular incision for this fracture. This is the most simple intraoral incision, 3 to 4 millimeter above the mucogingival junction, and directly we can see this region. The next, from the ease point of view, from approach is approaching this FZ region. Now there are different options. We can take the lateral brow incision, which will hide in the hairs, and during that the incision should be parallel to the hair direction so that the transection of the hair shafts will be avoided. Next option is a blepharoplasty, upper blepharoplasty in the crease we can put, and this will also give a very good exposure and hides well in the crease. In the old age, we have wrinkles here, so Procut is also option. And for the FZ, if you are taking coronal for arch, that will also give exposure. So next two are for the intraorbital rim, and one is the coronal, which we will discuss in the next slide. Now approaches for intraorbital rim. Now there are many options, like we can take subciliary, subtarsal or intraorbital rim, and additionally we can go transcutaneous. So we can go transcutaneous or transcutaneous. So which one to choose? So it's a totally a surgeon's preference, experience, beliefs that will decide it. But nowadays preferred or accepted is the transcutaneous, that is no incision on the skin. But it's not so. We should be knowing and trying. It's a learning curve, we can say. Like when we started initially, we started with the intraorbital rim. Then we have tried subciliary, subtarsal, and recently we started taking transconjunctival also. Now subciliary or subtarsal transcutaneous incisions. Now This can be taken like a skin muscle flap, or initially this incision is 2 millimeter below the cilia subciliary, and subtarsal is around 5 millimeter below the cilia. Now first we go skin, subcutaneous skin, then undermine a little bit. You will use the skin hooks, and small things are important in this, like the direction how we are applying the traction. We should be upward. If we retract it downward, this skin hook, then chances of button holing in this flap are there, because this is very thin skin. So a gentle traction, and with a blunt dissecting scissor, skin only flap, then we can go skin muscle flap. And most important thing which we and the beginner especially should remember is where to use this periosteal cut. So it is always below this infraorbital margin, never above this, otherwise it will hamper the attachment of the septum. So this periosteal cut is below the infraorbital margin. And in short, we should know this anatomy of the eyelid, like there is a tarsal plate and septum and this fat there, and the layers in this, like orbicularis oculi. So we have subciliary and subtarsal option, and in that skin flap or skin muscle flap. Now transconjunctival, this is through the conjunctiva. For that we need to put traction sutures and put the incision in the inferior fornix. Again, there are two options in this, like we can go either a preceptal or retroceptal. It is like options in options, like we have different options for infraorbital, and in that also we have two more options in transconjunctival. A preceptal need a little more meticulous dissection, whereas I would say a retroceptal is a more direct approach. Retract and put incision directly to the bone. Now only issue is with this is fat herniation will be there, but it can be easily managed with the wide retractors. In preceptal, we will give a septum cut here, be in front of the septum, and then periosteal incision, as already discussed, below the infraorbital margin. It's again a totally surgeon's preference where which approach we should use. Now coronal approach. Coronal approach, the design, taking into consideration the baldness pattern, and taking into consideration, we can go in the occipital region also in the bald patient. The aim is to hide the incision in the hair, behind the hair. So this will give exposure to the arch and abjad, very nice exposure we can obtain with this option. An important thing, a plane which is important is we should know in which layer the facial, now branch of facial now lies. So for that, we first the plane of dissection is above the pericranium in the subgaleal plane, which is a loose plane to which we dissect, and the facial now lies. To protect the facial now, a bony deep incision is given in the arch and which runs 45 degree up for the temporalis fascia. And when we take incision to the temporalis fascia, we will expose the fat also. So that indicates that you are in the right plane. And to that plane, expose and give a periosteal incision above the arch. This is how we can protect the facial. Now, the complications it can occur because of the fracture or because of our management. So there are a set of complications given, a long list is given, and the best way to protect them is knowing them and trying to prevent them. For that, important is proper assessment, proper planning, try to execute them properly, try to master each technique. Like different approaches we need to master, we need to focus on reduction. In short, if we want to see the complications, like persistent swelling can be there, infection can be there, not very common, dysmesis can be there, diplopia, maybe because of muscle entrapment, initial binocular diplopia, usually because of edema or hematoma, or because of the increase in the volume. And ophthalmos can be there, then blindness, not a very common complication, then facial asymmetry. If the reductions are not adequate, we should focus on bilateral symmetry intraoperatively. We should see whether the reduction is adequate. Sometimes if we just go by the bone-to-bone reduction, it is not adequate. We should compare with the contralateral side. Then ectropion, these are issues with the infraorbital incision, transcutaneous incision, like a contraction, scarring, and eversion of the eyelid may occur. And that won't look that big, means that is the bad thing about the infraorbital incision, that is unpredictable also many a times. So to prevent it, what we can do is in during the initial healing time, we can suspend the infraorbital lid with suspension suture, that is called cross stitch. So that can be done, or smile edema with massaging also can be managed. And because of the ectropion, the lid is not in contact with the sclera, and which will lead to epiphora also, that is excessive lacrimation can be there. then hardware problem like palpability. So the thing in this infraorbital region should be remembered, and try to take a hardware which are thin, like microplate 0.9 to 1 millimeter in this region, and even in abject region. Persistent pain, sinusitis is not that common, facial no palsy, but if you are in right plane in the coronal incision, can be avoided. Then scarring with proper closure can be avoided. Entropion, this is a complication with the transconjunctival incision. Like entropion is transcutaneous, and transconjunctival is entropion, that is inward tilt of the eyelid, which is also irritating because eyelashes will irritate the sclera. Then corneal abrasion can be there. So to prevent this, we can do this tarsorrhaphy suture, or in the transconjunctival, we can put the scleral corneal sheet. Then these are not very common. Paresthesia, it is said that if you do proper fixation, if the fractures are fixed, then paresthesia will recover soon. If they are not fixed and if they are moving, they may compress the nerve. Then not very common, non-union, mal-union. Then enophthalmos, if the floor reconstruction is not adequate, or sometimes it is because of the atrophy of the contents of the orbit, like fat atrophy. Sclerotial can be because of ectropion, and persistent lid edema, this can be the set of complications. Now, what is future in treating such cases? So we all are going virtual. So this surgical is also taking a lead, surgical approaches and the treatment part. Like we can plan it virtually, what we want to do. Then during surgery, that is during execution, we can confirm it with the intraoperative navigation, which will help whether the fragments are aligned properly or not. And to be doubly sure, we can verify it intraoperatively only with the intraoperative image. Like if you see our orthopedic people, whenever they reduce the fracture or if they put some implant, they confirm it intraoperatively with the radiographs. But this is not possible in our areas because there are so many superimpositions. So on the 2D X-rays, like C-arm, it is very difficult. So if this tool like intraoperative CT scan is there, that is can be the best thing which we can say. That is a blessing in we can say. Now we'll be discussing a few of our cases. Now the cases which I have selected are a little different approach than what is said. And we have justification also for why we have done so. This patient had a history of RTA 5 days back, and intraorally anterior open bite, premature contact in the posterior region. On the radiograph, like axial CT, segment in the arch, lateral wall of orbit fractured. We should see the floor intact or entrapment of muscle in the coronal and the sagittal view. And 3D helps in orientation of the rotation of the fracture, and also it helps in educating the patient also and explaining the patient what has exactly happened. Now the diagnosis was ZMC and along with the maxillar fracture. The plan was to do open reduction and fixation, and we decided to fix these sites. We wanted to exclude the exposure of this site. So the approach decided were hemicoronal and vestibular. With the hemicoronal, we could expose the arch and abject region there, and intraoral incision, the maxillar fracture and the buttress fracture were exposed. Occlusion established with the IMF. Fracture reduced and fixed with the plates, two screws on each side. We try to engage each fragment with two screws in the buttress, L plate, and maxillary fracture also fixed. So this is a pre-op 3D, and same on the PNS, we can compare that each segment, two screws and well aligned, anatomically reduced. Same can be compared on the submental vertex postoperatively with the axial pre-op CT. The segment is properly aligned. The hemicoronal approach, which is taken usually in such cases, it sometimes looks like overdoing or overkill or too much extensive. But when we see in the follow-up, no one can make out whether the incision is given. So that is the beauty of this incision. So we can say that his approach appears radical initially, but it hides very well. And one issue, like we may feel that facial nerve may be damaged, but if you are in the right plane, there is a rare possibility that we may damage it. And on the next day, usually we ask the patient for these movements to check whether we have damaged the facial nerve or not, hydrogenically. So this is showing that the facial nerve function is intact, counting and closing the eye. Initially, in the post-op time, there may be a palsy. That may be transient. That may be because of retraction injury or because of the edema. But over a period of time, that will resolve. Occlusion re-established and mouth opening also achieved. And you can see the symmetry achieved in the bird's eye and the worm's eye view. So case two, this patient reported 15 days after the trauma. Now, this is important. When patient reports, this is 15 days, and this will change the treatment. If you would have been reported early, the treatment would have been different. Now, prominence here, depression here, and mouth opening reduced. On the CT, we can see that the arch displays inward, and which is causing interference in the movement of the mandible, impinging on the coronoid. Same can be seen on the submental vertex view. So, as I already said, the treatment depends also on when patient report. If the patient would have been reported early, this maneuver would have worked. Like just reduction would have been sufficient. But as he reported late, initial fibrosis has occurred. We tried to apply
Dr. Nelima. Dr. Nelima, are you there?
Hello.
There is some interruption, I guess.
Yeah, hello.
Yes, Kshitij, we can hear you.
Yeah. In life, it happens. Unplanned things. So, am I back now? Visible. Screen yes, is also visible, na?
Yeah, yeah, screen is visible. Please carry on.
There was electricity failure. So, I was here. Like, if this patient would have been reported early, just the Keel's technique, the reduction would have been, maybe we could have achieved the reduction. But as he reported late, 15 days after, so what happened? This didn't work. So the as the plan B was ready. So one second. Yeah. So we exposed the site using the coronal incision, and we could see initial healing there. So that's why it was not yielding. So we need to do refracture with the scissors of these sites, and then the reduction achieved. And fixation done. This can be appreciated better on the post-op image. Usually, we are eager to see the post-op radiographs. On the next day, usually we try to do take the radiograph, and this is really satisfying moment that we have achieved the safety with the other side. Now, one more point I would like to make here is we call this a zygomatic arch, but we should not try to make it like an arch. We should try to understand that this is not an arc, this is a flat area, and this flatness should be maintained. Sometimes out of over enthusiasm, what we do, we try to make it like an arc, and it is overbending and it will lead to cosmetic deformity. Plus the manner prominence will also be gone because of that. So we should try to maintain this flatness. Case 3, again a similar case where we have taken a similar approach like hemicoronal and intraoral only. Why I placed only these three cases? This is the last case which I am showing. Because in these three sets of cases, we avoided this infraorbital incision. The reason is because sometimes it leads to anesthetic like ectropion, epiphora, and again, this is not a very strong area. So unless mandatory, like if you need a planning for floor reconstruction, then it is there is no option. Then we need to take this incision. We can avoid this incision for the aesthetic reason. No incision on the skin. So in conclusion, we need to evaluate each case individually because each case is different. No case, two cases matches. Nature of treatment depends on preoperative imaging analysis and surgical findings. That was diversity in treatment options exist. Like already we have seen there are different options which we can choose, and in that options there are more options. Like choices in choices exist in ZMC.
Oh.
So surgeon's judgment and ability to apply a technique. Hello.
Yes, Shitij.
Surgeon's judgment. Yeah. Audible na? Abhilasha?
Yes,
audible. Yeah.
Yes, we hear you.
Yeah, I am on the last point. So surgeon's judgment and ability to apply a technique is crucial for getting satisfactory results. Different techniques available, different ways of managing the case. So it's surgeon's judgment, its clinical acumen, his experiences that decide which technique should be used. Thank you all for your patient listening. And
yeah, thank you, Dr. Shetty. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Shetish. Very comprehensive presentation, I can say. Now, there are a few questions from the audience, so I will just read it for you. The first question is from Dr. Srikant Vanjari. He's asking, like, malunited ZMC fracture, which are causing trismus, should we refracture or we should remove coronoid process? That is the question.
Very good question. See, again, logically, we need to think. And what patient wants. I must say it's a very beautiful question. Like the issue is patient is coming, why he's coming? Whether he wants his trismus to be corrected?
Yeah.
Whether he wants his aesthetic correction. So better way is to do refracture. So both things will be addressed. We are removing the mechanical lock plus the aesthetic contour will be re-established. Rarely we do coronarectomy, but logically may be an option, but what should be the reason for doing coronarectomy? When we can do, say, we are doing surgery to do for betterment. So aesthetic correction additionally, we can do it when we are.
Okay.
But logically, he is right. Can be done.
Okay. So the next question, I am only asking. So
yeah.
I just want to know what are the chances of this trigeminocardiac reflex while this elevating this zygoma, this fracture cases?
Yeah, that reflex possibility is always there when we are around in maxillofacial region.
Yeah.
And anesthetist should be told that we are doing the maneuver and that is possible. Like bradycardia may occur and may have to just, it will go with the time or maybe atropine may be needed. But we should be knowing that this reflex possibility is there and it should be told to the anesthetist also.
Okay. Yeah, in few of us, our cases, it has happened. So that's what I wanted to know.
That possibility is there. Usually, anesthetist only ask us to stop for some time. Don't manipulate when such things happen.
Yeah. And one more question there is there in everyone's mind, like how this zygomatic arch should be approached? Means few of us, like they're selecting for the direct approach over the skin. Few of us like preferring this coronal approach, you can say. So what is your line of approach?
Now arch, if it is slightly displaced, even if we don't manage, this is okay. If it is not causing any functional or aesthetic issues. Many a time on radiograph, we see that it is depressed. But clinically, there is no such deformity. So we can leave such cases. When we have to address, if the patient reports early, the best thing is just try to reduce it with some indirect technique. With any of the indirect technique, like the intraoral Quinn's technique, or are there different techniques given, like Quinn's technique also to the coronoid, that is just for arch. And if it's stable, no fixation is needed. If we want to be more sure, then indirect fixation are also there. Like we can put some hard thing here, and with the wires or sutures, we can give some temporary support to that region. Also in the postoperative, something that will prevent the displacement, that can be done. Now, your question was direct incision or hemicoronal. Now, yeah. No one would like a direct incision on the face. That is the point number one. Plus, if we when we are taking direct incision, we are not sure about the scar, and additionally, the fascia now may get damaged. Direct incision or the face, fascia now may get damaged, and scar may be there. So, usually preferred is when we want to do fixation, always go for coronal.
Okay.
In many of the cases, usually we avoid fixing this part because it looks extensive. Usually we try to fix only FZ and a buttress. And this works in most of the cases. If needed, if comminution is there, then only. And sometimes additionally, lipo 2-3 fractures are there. So we need more sturdy fixation. In that cases, we exclude.
Okay. So the next question is there again. Just a minute. The question is, why is close reduction of ZMC and arch fracture is successful in spite of number of fixation?
Why is ZMC indirect reduction successful?
No, why is close reduction of ZMC and arch fracture is successful in spite of number of fixation? Means whether we are preferring 2 points or 3 points of fixation like that.
Yeah, that depends. If like the linear fracture is there,
yeah,
and patient reports early, and we just reduce it, it's favorable. We have seen excess of rotations also. There is no comminution at any point. We just reduce, it will click sound we will hear, and it will lock the fragment which lock with each other. And so it will be stable. When we apply pressure also, it won't move. That means it's sufficient. Now, if some comminution at the fracture sites is there, if the excess of rotation, we can say unfavorable, and if patient reports late that fibrosis has occurred or some resorption at the fracture ends, so the bone will not lock with each other. That interdigitation will not be there. So it won't be that much stable. And it again depends on case to case. Sometimes only 1 point is sufficient. Sometimes that way we can go. Stage-wise we can go. On table we can take a call. In such cases, like when we are in doubt whether it will be work or not, we can just do 1 point fixation, then check again with some force. If needed, FZ, that way we can work out.
Okay. Any other question from audience?
Even if difficult questions are there, so we have expert like Abhay Kamat sir, so he can also help us.
Yeah. Sir, what about this comminuted ZMC? Sometimes the cases are like that, too much pieces are there in this buttress region. So shall we open it or just leave it like that?
That again depends. If the plan is to fix them, multiple fractures on the face are there, so we need to we generally do fixations at almost all the areas. So the thing is, we need to gap that area. If the bone loss also is there, we need to gap that defect with the plate, and if needed, we can do reconstruction with some bone. Like even we can take a calvarial bone if you have taken the bicoronal and can reconstruct it.
Okay.
Abhay?
Yes, Abhay, boss.
Yes. Any inputs, please?
It's a very comprehensive presentation by Kshitij. I must congratulate him. Two things which I would like to add in this presentation is the cases what Kshitij has portrayed, majority of them requiring a hemicoronal. So when we speak about hemicoronal, there is a possible fear laden in the minds of youngsters. Possibly when we were PGs also, we were worried about the facial nerve. But as Kshitij said, it's the fascia what decides, it's the treatment or the way you approach the fractures. Hemicoronal is an excellent approach. The simplest way to have a knowledge about the facial nerve is to dissect above the deep temporalis fascia. If you see the article by Adelis, there is a suprafacial and a deep facial approach. Now, suprafacial approach is when you take a point from the supraorbital rim you take a point of 1 to 1.5 centimeters above the supraorbital rim on the lateral aspect, make a point there, and then get that point to be drawn all the way to the zygomatic arch. So it forms a corridor there. And that corridor is where you incise the fascia and you do a dissection just above the fat. Once you incise the fascia, the fat which is there, what I'm speaking about is the temporal fat, not the Bichette's buccal fat pad, which is more medial to the muscle. What I'm talking is the temporal fat. So you dissect above and stay above the fat and dissect, you automatically go get down into the space where you reach the zygomatic arch. That's one point. And the other point I would like to make is when you have fractures of the zygomatic arch, one clinical sign which is most important is the thumbprint appearance. The thumbprint appearance. This thumbprint appearance is something which we clearly see on the zygomatic arch, which gives you an indication clinically that there is a fracture. And when we look at the PNS view, as Rowan Williams rightly quoted, you need to see the lines of Dolan and Jacob. That's the reverse elephant. If there is a disruption in the lines of Dolan and Jacob, automatically you know that you need to understand and fix these fractures. And regarding the use of C-arm, Kshitij spoke about it. I think C-arm is a very versatile tool, possibly even for patients who have arch fractures. I have been using C-arm now extensively over these years, and we have understood the mechanism where it needs to be oriented at 5 degrees angulation by a point drawn from the menton to the bregma, very similar to the submento vertex projection. I think C-arm from a clinical point or a clinical standoff is very essential from a medico-legal perspective, because you never know if the arch goes back in. So you need to stabilize these arches. There are various methods. You can put in a metal plate. You can put in a number zero oropharyngeal airway there and keep it in place for six to 10 days till the consolidation is over. And the last point I would like to make is the zygomaticosphenoid. Most of the times when the comminution is very high and the amount of rotation of the zygomatic complex is compromised, you need to remember from our orthognathic knowledge that the interzygomatic width to the intergonial width is nearly 1:2. So you need to take that reference as well. And that can be understood on the CT scan preoperatively what is done. And the three-dimensional analysis of a zygomatic complex is predominantly understood by realigning the zygomaticosphenoid suture irrespective of the degree of comminution at the frontozygomatic as well as the maxillary process of the zygoma. So if this zygomatic sphenoid gets aligned, believe me, automatically you get your transverse projection right. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Abhay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
Abhay. Thank you. Abhay, you have a big fan following all over India.
No, absolutely.
Hi, Abhay, sir.
Hi, Abhilasha. It's basically that we give back what we have learned from our times. We have all gone through learning phases. It's time we give back what is there. I think in terms of COVID, we very well understood one point, that we have to help each other and uplift our society. That's the way I look at it, life. When we are there, help one another. And when you're gone, you really obviously can't. It's better to help here rather than taking the knowledge to the grave.
Very true.
Abhilasha.
Yes, sir.
Just 1 minute. Can you share the screen?
Yes.
Before we do the set, if there are no more questions, Surendra, actually there was some
one.
There's a question.
Yeah, one question is there, sir. Shall I ask?
Yeah,
just a minute.
You go ahead, Surendra. You go ahead.
Yeah, one question is there, like about Manson's criteria. Manson's criteria from Zui Karmarkar.
Okay. Like Manson's has given high energy and low energy fractures.
Yeah.
That is one thing. And like low energy are monofragment, high energy multifragment, and accordingly we need to manage. Anything? I think.
Yeah. There are no more questions now.
So today actually there was a small technical issue. We lost power very briefly, and in that the net went off. I don't know how it happened, and then ultimately Surendra became the host, and he transferred it back to me. So we apologize for the technical glitch that happened during the presentation. So this is for our the big event coming up next week. Is there more, Abhilasha?
Just a second, sir.
Yeah. So we are going to have the Ladies Week from 5th of July. We may reschedule our inaugural time to accommodate for the DCI webinar. So please do bear with us. These are the divas of maxillofacial surgery who have done so much for the specialty that we wish to acknowledge their contribution, especially Andrade Madam, who is a, you know, they are the real heroes and heroines, not the celluloid heroine, but the ones who work in the hospitals because they work miracles. Is there more? I think the schedule has to be shown. The schedule is from the 5th. The time would most probably get inaugural might get changed a bit. So thank you, Abhilasha. So this is from 5th, as you can see, from 5th till the 10th. Thank you. And Kshitij and Surendra, we have a small token of appreciation from our side. So please do accept it in just a moment. Abhay, thank you so much for joining. I mean, you are a lifesaver.
It's always a pleasure to be with you guys. Thank you so much for having me here. Thank you.
Sir, we hope to see you again, sir, for the coming webinar as well.
I will be there. I'll be there. 100%.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Abhay, sir, for your presence.
Thank you. Thank you, Kshitij. Thank you. Excellent presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
And Surendra, thank you for holding fort while we lost power for a brief while. So this is for you.
Sir, no problem. Yeah.
And thank you, everybody, for joining. Tomorrow, it is going to be Sainath Matsa. We're going to speak on hair restoration surgery. So please do join us at the same time, 11 o'clock. Right? So thank you, everybody. Thank you for this wonderful, when you join, you give us a lot of motivation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.